Hey, it's 2:05. Do we get started now?
I don't know. I was digging those tunes. Looks like we only have 19 people with us, so let's keep going with some disco until everybody else joins us. What do you guys think?
I love it. Let's do some more disco.
Woo!
Get this.
Look out, give the kid some room. He's taking over again.
Right.
Hooray, go, Tony!
I mean, those tunes are infectious. I don't care who you are. That's amazing. Hi, everyone, and welcome to the new and improved, recently renovated MEOC meetings. Thank you guys all for attending. It looks like some other folks are filtering in, but we will go ahead and get started. So just general meeting updates, please remain muted unless you are unmuting to speak and, you know, all the other great virtual meeting guidelines. So welcome again, everyone, to the updated MEOC series. This MEOC standing for Member Engagement and Outreach Committee. Sorry about that. Working on trying to not have abbreviations for everything. So my name is Sarah Miller. She, her are my pronouns, and I am the Engagement and Collaboration Manager for the CCO Quality Assurance Team here at the Oregon Health Authority. And it is my team who will be hosting these meetings going forward. So I will be co-facilitating this meeting today with our stellar engagement analyst, Veronica Herrera, who you may have seen in facilitating here. In a brief review of our agenda for this meeting, welcome. I will introduce you to the team who is behind these meetings. We will discuss some basics about the meeting series and some changes with our redesign. Sean McEnulty, his team will be giving us an update on the OHP Bridge Initiative. And we will have our very first Spotlight On series kick off with Pacific Source, who will be sharing with us some best practices and lessons learned in their recent radio campaign. And then we will close out today with a roundtable discussion and questions and input for future meetings. Okay, so who is the team leading these meetings and what do we do? So the CCO engagement and collaboration team is a subgroup of the wider CCO quality assurance team within the Medicaid Services Division. As some of you may be aware, in March of this year, the CCO QA team expanded and created three distinct departments. So we have quality of care, performance analytics, and of course, engagement and collaboration. Within the engagement and collaboration group, some of our specific focuses are to assist CCOs with their compliance in state and federal rules, to resolve audit issues, to optimize member materials, and to collaborate with all of our relevant partners to improve health policy, equity inclusion, and communication and accessibility. So, now I'd like to introduce you to my amazing team. Right now, our team is tiny but mighty. We will be growing with two positions that are coming soon. And about half of our team is newer to the organization, including myself, but we all have extensive shared skills in public health and truly a passion for serving our communities. So myself, as previously stated, I am the new ENC manager. I have spent the majority of my career in healthcare, primarily in areas of strategic planning, quality and performance improvement, and organizational optimization. Tiffany Reagan. So you may recognize her as she has previously managed virtually all of the ENC work for the CCO QA team. And because of her extensive acumen and experience, as well as her stellar leadership, she has recently been promoted to the senior engagement analyst on our team. And while her role is new, she still brings the exact same love of language access and public service that you have all come to know and love. Brisna Garcia, she is an engagement analyst on our team with deep experience in developing learning tools and resources, which is a phenomenal attribute to have. She also brings experience interpreting complex rules and regulations, as well as a passion for increasing access and accessibility. Veronica Herrera, she is our lead architect for the MEOC redesign and development. She also has extensive experience in public health with communications, data analysis, and strategic planning. And Janet Herb, she is also someone who may be familiar to you as she has worked in managing the Oral Health Forum and other areas in the past. She is a contract specialist slash wizard who has focused expertise in dual eligibility and communications. So welcome to the ENC team. And just a high-level overview of some of the things that we do, our existing bodies of work. We manage, create, and review member-facing materials, such as the Model Member Handbook, the NOABD forms, like Notice of Adverse Benefit Determination, and other material member reviews. Sorry about that. I'm wearing lip gloss for the first time in forever, and it keeps catching. We also conduct and oversee audits and reviews. We provide technical assistance and trainings for CCOs. And of course, our communications, we have web content and our CCO weekly newsletter. And in the vein of optimizing communications and responding to inquiries efficiently, we have a new email. So it is right there, our new team email. It is specifically for our team, so please do not hesitate to reach out should you need. And we have a website coming soon. It is currently under construction. All right. So moving to the focus of our meetings, we wanted to share some of what has changed and what is to come. So updates to MEOC. So some elements of the previous MEOC structure still exist, but our intent and our audience has expanded. So green stars that you see there on the screen indicate new or changed elements. And so I'll briefly go over those. So facilitation, the new element there is that we are now in charge of facilitating these meetings. Our cadence remains the same. It's monthly. The platform remains the same virtually. However, we have a potential for hybrid meetings. I know that this meeting has had hybrid options in the past. We'll have a little bit of a poll later on that you can contribute to in terms of your preferences in that potential meeting structure. The agenda. So our agenda will continue to be co-created within OHA and with CCO partners. However, we're going to have additional relevant partners available to add to the agenda, including a smart sheet. So the link will be posted here soon for agenda development. So any and all can suggest areas that you would like to have added to our agenda that we may want to discuss in the future. And then information sharing. So we'll still have our CCO weekly newsletter. And the MEOC website is still up. So the previous one that we had, and it is also in transition and under construction. So it is still available. You can go to it right now. We have updated certain elements to it. We are working on updating additional ones. But this is where you will be able to see slides, meeting recordings, et cetera. This is where you will be able to get those. So current scope and purpose. So part of the expanded intent for these meetings comes for a couple of different reasons. We all serve the exact same population. We all have the same intent, and we all want to improve and optimize this process. And so we want to create a respectful and collaborative forum within these MEOC meetings to explore and share how we can optimize the service that we provide to our OHP members. So OHA and CCOs, how can we come to the table together, share input on policies, discuss and resolve issues that arise related to communication and outreach? How can we optimize our service to the population? And CCOs, we want to provide a forum and a platform for folks to share information and resources and work together. And this includes best practices. You know, we here at OHA, we get the unique opportunity to be able to see all the incredible work that's being done across CCOs in serving the population in multiple different ways. And yet, some of these things are not shared. So we want to provide a format for CCOs to be able to present and share some of the great work that they're doing in their communities and, you know, in implementation policies, implementation for policies and procedures. How are you effectively rolling out these rules and regulations? Are there templates that we can share? We really want to be able to share and increase that transparency amongst our CCO partners to be able to share information and resources together. And then finally, OHA plus CCO plus our community partners, that's just going to be an explosion of awesomeness, which is what we hope these MEOC meetings will be. So we really want to explore how can we effectively translate policy and rule into action and impact. What does that look like, and how can we share that work and increase transparency amongst us all? Veronica will be reviewing some of our proposed agenda topics here for this meeting series a little bit more in detail, but generally speaking, this is the intent for those meetings, and we welcome wholeheartedly your input and feedback as well.
So now we open the space for your feedback. So the previous slide was the current scope and purpose And so we want to get your feedback on how we can improve MEOC. So what should we change in the MEOC scope and purpose? Is there anything you want to add or remove? Is there something that hasn't been part of meetings consistently and you want us to make sure that we add those topics in the agenda? Below there is a QR code if you want to submit your feedback anonymously. Brisna dropped that link in the chat. If you want to unmute, raise your hand, or drop something in the chat, your feedback will help us improve MEOC so we can utilize this time to improve our collaboration. Karina, do you want to go ahead and speak?
Yeah, hi, I'm Taryn A. Foltz. I'm a new marketing communications leader with the IHN CCO, and I'm newer to this line of business and membership population, and I spent my previous 9 years at Regent. And so I was wondering if either within the kind of best practices and resource review, if there was some thinking around how we can coordinate a little bit more closely to make sure that we're reaching our members digitally as well as through direct mail, since the research shows that that's the preference for those members to be receiving things like text messages instead of things in the mail. And so just putting that idea out there into the world to see if that's something that is appropriate for this forum and these kinds of conversations, and how we might all work together to move in that direction.
Yes, thank you for bringing that up. This is absolutely the forum. We would love to have that as a discussion. And so perhaps we can either take that on as a discussion item for a future agenda item where we can roundtable, or we can also bring it up today's roundtable, should we have time, to maybe open it up for some free range discussion about what everyone's doing in that realm, because I certainly would love to hear from folks what has and hasn't worked and kind of some of the, you know, methodology that's out there right now. Yeah. Thank you for bringing that up. Yes.
Dana?
Hi, so my name is Dana Sterringer. I work with Willamette Dental Group. And one of the things that we used to do in this meeting, and I think partly just because of, you know, the activities of the last several years with pandemic redeterminations and all that stuff, we've been kind of focused on all of that. But there was a lot of, you know, best practice sharing between plans about, you know, language in the handbook. And I know now that there's a handbook template that gets used, but it seems like there could be an opportunity there for some good input from the various plans and providers that are talked about in the handbook about their the services they provide and give that feedback. And so I don't know if there's an opportunity for that kind of input, if that's part of the intention of this work group, but that's, I know, something that we've done in the past.
Thanks, Dana. I appreciate that. Yes, member materials, optimization, discussing templates and maybe some, you know, best practices there. Absolutely in scope.
And if I may just kind of tag onto that too, you know, if there are any rule changes or that sort of thing that get, I know there's RACs that go along with those rules, but then a lot of times, you know, where you get some good feedback is in this work group as well, with if there's going to be any changes to any of those rules.
100%. Yeah. And that's actually a perfect segue into our next section, which talks about some of our proposed agenda items, which is actually something that you guys just kind of talked about. The QR code is still there. So if any of you folks who maybe didn't want to come off of mute or prefer to just send your feedback anonymously through our QR link, please do so. We are still welcoming any feedback on things that you would like to see as part of these meetings. But I'm going to go ahead and have Veronica transition to maybe some of our proposed agenda items, some of which have already been maybe touched on. And perhaps we can expand on some of our intents and then also get your opinions as well on whether or not that that would fit what you need for these meetings as well.
Yeah, thank you. So this is outlining each topic that we hope to address in each MEOC meeting as it's relevant to the work that we're doing in member engagement. So first, as you mentioned, Dana, reviewing rules. So here, we want to dedicate the time to review any state or federal rule changes and contract language as it relates to member engagement and communications. So, for example, we are seeing some changes in the Section 1557 of the ACA rule changes. And so this would include an overview of the rules, any changes of requirements for CCOs, when the effective dates are, how does implementation look, and any tools and resources. So we want to ensure that we are providing the best tools for CCO to understand these rules and in order to be compliant with them. Next, we have issue escalation. And so we want to dedicate this time for CCOs or OHA programs to ask questions. If there are any identified barriers or member issues, we can bring it to this meeting to resolve or to refer. So, for example, if we had a community resource partner who was seeing concerns around people with intellectual disabilities who have difficulty giving written consent for formal grievances, during this time, we would help in reviewing any OARs, any rules, memos to help understand the situation, what is required in the grievance process, and how we can advocate and resolve this concern. The next topic is the CCO spotlight and discussion. So in our goal for MEOC, we want to create a more collaborative learning space. So we are highly encouraging CCOs to share best practices and present on topics like project achievements, member engagement techniques, issue resolution, or their campaigns. So if a CCO wants to present a project, we want to hear how did they identify the need for this project? Who did they partner with? What was the process like for implementation? What was the final product? And were there any challenges or limitations? And so we want to emphasize the importance of resource sharing across CCO networks and how we can support. And with that, please schedule your CCO spotlight. So you can email us at our new email. Share the topic that you want to share and present and the month that you prefer. And if you have any questions about what to present or any support that you need for materials or presentation, we will be happy to help with that. Next is best practices and resource overview. So this time is dedicated to review any processes, ask questions, or clarify any expectations. So for example, if a CCO needed any technical assistance or training on certain processes like our member material review process, we can spend this time reviewing steps, when to submit, what to submit, where to submit, what are the expectations, and what are we looking for in these reviews. Also, if CCOs have questions about how other CCOs are informing members for health risk assessments or for their provider directory, CCOs that have had limitations and wonder how other CCOs are being successful, or if a CCO overcame that limitation, sharing those things that help them and training others to meet that mutual goal of ultimately helping and supporting our OHP members in their benefits and services. And last is the community voice. So in MEOC, we want to ensure that we are providing the opportunity for community members to learn about the work that we're doing and ensure that we have a community perspective in all of our materials, recommendations, and processes. So we hope to invite some of our CAC representatives and any resource partners to ensure that we have their opinions on these matters. And so with that, we have another time for feedback. So again, there is that QR code. If you want to submit anonymously, you can raise your hand or unmute. The questions are, is there something that you would like to see on this agenda in addition to what I just shared? How can we make this more interactive with CCOs? What are your thoughts on bringing members into this space? And how can we work together to make it a space that members or member representatives feel comfortable sharing OHP issues? No one has anything. Go ahead, Dana.
Yeah, I just was thinking, CCOs are regularly getting input and feedback from their members through their CACs. And so just wondering whether or not that's a avenue, a way to get, share that feedback here is to, bring kind of like a CAC report or to have something where, CCOs are saying, here's, we're getting this directly from our members, as something to look through. So, thinking of, ways we're already getting that information and kind of doubling down on it. And an OHA, for that matter, has, gets member input through, several channels as well. So maybe there's just like a section on the agenda where we talk about, what we've heard from members and, through what venues and
I like that. Thank you, Dana. I'll note that. Gustavo?
Hi, everyone. I'm totally new to this space. However, it's the first time that I'm in this meeting. I just started working in health a little bit ago, but I've been collaborating, in different areas through my career when it comes to health. And I was wondering, one of the things that, and I'm not completing all the work that has been done, but when you're saying bringing members, I know there's people who are getting the services from OHP. So one of the pieces that I've learned the last year working in Rockwood in this area, is that a lot of refugees, immigrants, and people who are being oppressed, they have a lot harder time to use some of the services. And the way that I've seen it, that using popular education and going where they are, that's the thing that's what I've seen that works the best, specifically with one of the counties that I've been collaborating by volunteering with a couple groups. So I don't know if you have done that before, like if you have used popular education in a way that you go to them, to wherever they are, and then listen to them. Because the thing is, if you don't build trust, that's what I have learned. Like if you don't build trust, you won't have the whole story. People won't be able to really share how the services work. They because sometimes they don't even know how it works culturally, and sometimes, with the language, a lot of these people come from other countries where the health systems are already, broken and it's just a lot different. So just getting used to a different system it's a whole other, you know, level of empowerment than some of these communities need to have. So in order to do that, I've seen that popular education has worked. Have you done anything like that in the past? And thank you.
Thank you, Gustavo. I would defer to maybe some of our community partners who might be on the call in terms of outreach efforts that they may be aware of. Would anyone like to join in on or could speak to what Gustavo was referring to in terms of outreach? I see Maria. And Michelle, we will get to you in just a minute, I promise you. Maria, do you have something for Gustavo?
Yes, no, thank you very much. I wanted to wait my turn in line. But hello, everyone. Maria Vargas, Communication Officer for Oregon Health Authority's Community Partner Outreach Program, also known as CPOP. And I'm so grateful that you mentioned this, Gustavo. Yes, absolutely. Popular education is something that we talk and train on. CPOP offers a community health worker training for our partners in our network. And as you know, that is one of the methodologies in community health worker work. And so, yes, I agree that is very important, and it is a way to reach people in a lot more effective way. Thank you.
Thank you. Michelle, do you have something to add?
I just a little bit of feedback on this slide. That maybe we can take into consideration, and it's related to bringing members into this space. I think that that's such an awesome idea to, you know, and I know that we've had some members join this meeting in the past as well. I wonder if we maybe have that for every meeting though, or if there's more of those internal meetings or discussions that we can have just to make it more meaningful to members when they do join. And then for those more internal to have CCOs be able to talk about maybe some of the back end stuff, the behind the scenes stuff that members, you know, that aren't necessarily involved in. Just some feedback, you know, if we're talking about bringing CCOs together and having some of those candid conversations about how we move through stuff. Some of that might be sensitive, and we might just want to think about that agenda and, you know, having some of those stop breaks. Maybe it's every other meeting that members are joining as well, or something like that.
That's a great call out, Michelle. Thank you so much for bringing that up for consideration. I appreciate that. Absolutely.
Okay, moving forward. Again, if you have any thoughts later, feel free to use the link or the QR code and submit any other feedback that you might have. Okay, so
I'm sorry, can I ask a quick question? Sorry.
Yes.
What is the QR code for?
If you want to submit any other feedback anonymously, or you don't think about a thought later, it's the same questions that we just addressed.
Okay, and I guess I'm just not sure how, who is the audience for the QR code?
Anyone in the MEOC meeting currently?
Okay, but we also have like email addresses and stuff, right? Is that, I mean, is the QR code like, it goes to a website that
it just goes to a form?
I guess I'm not sure what the...
Yeah, we can just do an email, but if in case anyone wanted to anonymously provide feedback, that was an option just in case. And so if someone didn't feel comfortable sharing it out loud, that was the option. So it's the same questions that we just addressed for feedback for the agenda and then feedback for the scope and purpose.
Okay, thanks. I guess I'm just trying to think of, like, if people don't have a smartphone, how are they submitting feedback to you?
Yes, Brisna is dropping a link in the chat to the form.
Okay, thanks.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for that clarification.
So we, in MEOC, we are aiming to eliminate any duplicative information and make MEOC more specific to member engagement strategies and collaboration with our relevant partners. And so in the past, there might have been an update or topic that was brought up. And so we want to try to eliminate redundancy and things that are being repeated at different meetings. So this is a list of all the OHA meetings, but some of the OHA meetings related to CCOs. And you will get the slides, or the slides will be posted on the website. So you can click and learn more about some of the goals for these different work groups and committees. So you can identify where you can find that other information. Okay, and with that, are there any other questions on MEOC transition? Okay. I'll be checking in the chat too. We'll go ahead and move to OHP bridge and unwinding updates. I think that might be Sean.
Katie Waldo here.
For the OHP bridge. Yeah, and Sean and I are going to approach it together, I believe. Let me get my, do you have slides that have been sent to you?
Yes, I can.
Okay, amazing. Okay, great. Hi, everyone. My name is Katie Waldo. Like I said, I use she, her pronouns, and I am the lead project manager for OHP Bridge in the Office of Health Policy. So we're here to give you a couple updates on OHP Bridge. I think we presented back in the spring. I'm trying to remember. So there might be a couple repeats, bits of information for you all if you were there for that. But hopefully some new updated useful information for you all as well. So just to kind of set the stage and give a broad overview and background for those of you who maybe are not as familiar with this benefit package, OHP Bridge is a new benefit for adults with higher incomes in Oregon. It specifically serves people who have incomes up to 200% of the federal poverty level, are between the ages of 19 and 64, do not have access to another form of affordable health insurance. So this is a key difference between OHP Bridge and sort of more traditional OHP, and who have an eligible immigration or citizenship status. It is almost the exact same as OHP Plus, with a few minor differences. And then it is like traditional OHP, is a free coverage option with no member costs, including copays or deductibles. We can go on to the next slide. So we will have two sort of sub programs that are providing largely the same benefit. And so we've kind of outlined the naming conventions here for you all. So we have the two sub-programs, our OHP Bridge Basic Health Program. This is the coverage option that will cover most of our OHP Bridge members. And then we also have OHP Bridge Basic Medicaid. And this was the option that we developed in order to ensure that American Indian and Alaskan Native members were able to maintain their right to choice between CCO and fee-for-service coverage. So on OHP Bridge Basic Health Program, members must receive coverage through a CCO. There is no fee-for-service option. However, on OHP Bridge Basic Medicaid, we are able to offer both. The benefit package will show up in the system in MMIS as BRG and will be Puente OHP for our Spanish-speaking members. We can go ahead on to the next slide. So really exciting news for us and hopefully for all of you as well is that we launched this new benefit on July 1st of this year. So we've got some numbers for you that are from sort of the month of July. We have slightly updated numbers somewhere, but we weren't able to get a hold of them for this presentation. So as of July 1st, we had roughly 25,700 people who had moved over or that we were tracking. So about 23,000 people moved to OHP Bridge effective July 1st. About 1,600 people remained on our temporary Medicaid expansion. And those were people that were pending for the review. So we've sent them RFIs and are waiting for information. I think maybe someone is unmuted. And then we've got about 1,300 people that were moved to another medical eligibility category, such as traditional Medicaid, and about 3 people that were closed due to a valid reason, such as them closing their coverage on their own. So we're really excited to see people start to move over and receive coverage through this new benefit. So we understand that it's always complicated and a little bit confusing launching a new benefit or new program across the state. So we wanted to highlight for you all a couple of resources that are available for you all to learn more about the program and to share with your contacts who might be working to guide people on to this new benefit or who might have questions. So the first of these is our partner training, which became available on May 15th. It's available in both English and Spanish at the links on the screen. It takes roughly an hour to complete the training, and there's a lot of really good information just to get you started and lay sort of the groundwork, answer some of those key questions. So we wanted to highlight that first. On to the next slide. We also have a website that we are consistently updating and working to make sure has the most up-to-date information and the answers that the key questions that we're receiving. So this is also available in both English and Spanish, and there's 2 key resources we wanted to point out for you all. The first is our FAQ. Again, we are constantly updating this document. It has the most frequently asked questions that we receive from people. And as we continue to get more questions from the public and from our community partners, we are trying to identify sort of repeat questions that should be added in. So I always encourage checking that out. I also really encourage people to use the keyword search when they're navigating that document. We're trying to make sure that the questions are written in the way that they would be asked, but sometimes that doesn't happen, or people ask the same question in a lot of different ways. So I encourage using the, you know, the Control F keyword search option if you're not finding the information in the contents page of that document. We also have our outreach toolkit, which is also available on the website. This has a lot of good visuals, talking points, some really great links that will also provide some great resources for people working, especially with members and people who are interested in learning more about the program. That's also a really good resource for learning more about the sort of enrollment periods and start dates for coverage. We've got some really great visuals in that toolkit that kind of presented in an easier to understand way than sometimes the written form. CPOP also has some great updated income guidelines available on their server and group site. So I also wanted to flag that. We also have some more outreach materials as part of our Get It, Use It, Keep It campaign. These are available in English and Spanish and just provide some of our key broad overview on how to get your coverage, how to use it, and how to keep it. And it includes things like RAC cards and social media posts if those are useful for you all. We will be doing sort of an updated form of some of these materials as we head into open enrollment for the marketplace that will be a bit more focused on OHP Bridge specifically. So also keep an eye out for those.
And if you're wanting to align with outreach messaging, take a look at those. We've been getting some asks for kind of outreach focused things towards members. That's what this is intended for, as opposed to the information we mentioned on the previous slide is really informational for partners. So if it's the purple stuff, that's the stuff for you all yourselves, as opposed to this health coverage, get it, use it, keep it stuff is the member facing sort of things.
Thanks, Sean. We also have a newer sort of, we're a couple months into it now, but our sister and community partners inquiry process. So we have, we were trying to find the most effective way for people to submit questions that allowed them a lot of different options while also sort of streamlining the work for our very small teams that are responsible for responding to these questions. So we have sort of created this option where community partners and assisters can submit questions directly to the OHP Bridge team in a couple of different ways. The first is through the CPOP regional outreach coordinators. CPOP has been an incredible partner throughout the OHP Bridge process, and we're so grateful for them. And so you can submit your questions to the ROCs, and they will sort of send the questions our way. And then we also have an OHP Bridge email where people can submit questions in writing there. They can also sign up for our office hours through the registration form, and they can submit a question when they register, or they can just attend the office hours. And what we do is we collect all the questions that come in through these various avenues. And then about a week before we host our office hours, our policy and eligibility teams sit down, we read through all the questions, we develop answers. And then at the office hours of that month, we then present all the questions with the answers. And this also helps us identify questions that need to be added to the FAQ, and it ensures that questions that one person might have, other people probably have. So we make sure that those questions and answers get out to the general public as well. So we encourage people to, you know, continue to submit their questions. We get a lot every month, and it's really exciting to see. I do want to note that we accept questions up to a week prior to the office hours, and then anything submitted in the week leading up to that month, it goes to the next month. So for instance, if you were to submit questions 1 week prior to the August office hours, then that those questions would get bumped to September, just to make sure we have enough time to answer them. We also respond to everybody that submitted written questions, and we send the answers out to all of those folks after so that they have them. So just wanted to let everyone know that's available, and we've extended those through December, I believe. We can go on to next. The last update that we have for you all is that we are, or at least from the OHP Bridge side, is that we are launching an OHP Bridge Advisory Committee in the fall. This was something that was suggested to us through the task force recommendations. So it's intended to kind of mimic the MAC and HIMAC structures. But we do want to note it is not a decision-making body. The purpose of this committee is to provide recommendations for the program. A really key piece of this is going to be our trust fund. So for those of you who are not as familiar with the sort of financial side of the BHP and OHP Bridge, a large chunk of the program is funded through what's called a BHP trust fund. And as that expands, potentially it might, we're waiting to see kind of what it looks like as we go through now that the program is live, but as the trust fund kind of becomes healthier and potentially expands, there may be the option to expand coverage in the future, including expanding the benefit package. So one of the roles of the advisory committee could be to sort of guide that expansion if it becomes an option. They'll also help with things like member outreach and communication, providing an avenue for the community to provide us feedback on the program, and also help with federal negotiations and reporting. So this is a brand new committee. So we are currently recruiting for all of the available seats, which is, I think, comes out to roughly 13 seats. And those are listed here on the screen, but we can go on to the next slide. And so I wanted to note that the recruitment is now open. It opened on Monday, the 19th, so earlier this week. We have applications available in English and Spanish, and those are available at the link on the screen. And then we also have a web page for the OBAC, which provides a little bit more information and also provides a bit of a more detailed recruitment announcement for people who want to know a little bit more about what's involved in being on the committee. And we do want to note that two of the seats on the committee are reserved for OHP Bridge members. We're aware that those seats might be a little bit harder to fill here at the beginning while people are just, just starting to get onto this benefit and receive coverage through it. But we are hoping that in the future, those seats will be able to be filled. We also have seats available for assisters and community partners and people that are specialists in things like health equity. So we're really excited to see those seats filled, and we've started to get applications already, and we're seeing a really great diverse group of people submitting applications. So we're excited to see what the committee looks like. I think that's it for the OBAC and for OHP Bridge updates. I don't know, Sean, if there was anything you wanted to add.
Just wanted to take a moment to note, I didn't bring a slide for this, that as part of our summer unwinding renewals, there are some renewals happening right now over the summer. Those are more likely to be either over 65 or disabled. So given the higher priority renewals, we do have some people, their case managers, if they have one, as well as our call center, doing some active calls to members to get them scheduled for interviews, if that's what they need to complete, as well as just reminding them of the upcoming renewal. So if you're hearing from members that they're actively getting a call from the state, that is happening with these summer renewals, in contrast to previously in the cycle where that was very rare. So just wanted to include that note. Other than that, I didn't have any slides there, but I'm happy to take questions.
Yeah, couple hands up. Hi, Lindsay.
Hi, this is Lindsay from UAJ. I have a question. We have experienced quite a few calls from our members who are receiving text messages from OHA, and I believe it says for them to call the CCO about enrollment issues or questions. I'm not sure of the exact verbiage, but the text message is referring them back to the CCO. However, the CCO can't help with them signing back up. So then we're having to refer them back to the state instead. So I don't know if we have any influence on what that text message says, but it would be really helpful if it provided the state information instead of the CCO information, because we are experiencing a lot of frustration with our members going to the CCO and we can't help. So we're referring them somewhere else and kind of feels like a runaround a little.
Yeah, that does sound concerning. Would love to correct that if we can find out where it is. Any additional details you're able to find on that would be helpful. I'll put my email in the chat, but I'll ask around and try to track that down and see if we can identify where that's coming from.
Thank you.
Mallory.
Yeah, hi. Mallory Roberts with Pacific Source. You had just one of the earlier slides mentioned 25,000 Bridge members, and I'm wondering if those were folks who came over from that TME population, or if it's new members, if it's both, if that's like total Bridge members.
Yeah, so the 25,000 is sort of total members that we've been tracking. I want to note that the 22,784 is the people that were moved to OHP Bridge effective July 1. And these numbers have changed slightly since, you know, it's been about a month and a half since the launch. But the 22,700 roughly, my understanding is that they were the people that were automatically moved over from the TME onto OHP Bridge. So they weren't people actively applying for the program. I think Laurel's online though, is that correct?
Yes, I was just typing in chat that the 25,000 number is the number of individuals who were enrolled in the temporary Medicaid expansion at the time that the program went live. And then the numbers that you see here is what happened to them after the program went live. So that all of those 22,000 individuals came from the TME. And as Katie said, we do have updated numbers. We just haven't had the chance to update all of these yet. So we have been seeing this program grow even just in the past month.
Awesome. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for the question. I don't see anything in the chat. I think we can hand it back.
Thank you, Katie and Sean. Now we'll be moving forward with our first CCO spotlight. So we have Pacific Source team here to present about their radio campaign.
Awesome. Hi, everyone. My name is Zaira Flores Marin. My pronouns are she, her, ella for those who speak Spanish, and I am the CCO director for the Marion and Polk region here at Pacific Source. If you don't mind, I'd love to go on to the next screen so I can allow the rest of my team who will be co-presenting with me to introduce myself. And then on here, you will also be able to see our agenda for today. So I'll hand it over to Mallory, and then Mallory, if you can then hand it over to Gustavo and then Martha.
Of course. Thanks, Syra. Hi, my name is Mallory Roberts. I am a Medicaid business analyst with Pacific Source. I report directly to our VP of Medicaid, work really closely with our CCO directors and community health coordinators to help navigate and implement some of these Medicaid, you know, expansions and program changes such as HOP. Gustavo?
Hi, everyone. My name is Gustavo Gutierrez Gomez, and I am the bilingual community health coordinator. My pronouns are he, and él. Thank you. And there is Martha.
Hi, everybody. My name is Martha Edwards. I use she, her, Aya pronouns, and I'm the health equity strategist for Pacific Source. I am a part of the community health department, but I work very closely with our Medicaid admin team.
Perfect. Thank you all. So we'll go on to the next page to talk a little bit about our overall strategies. And we're just going to focus on the last two that are bolded. But I do want to share that, well, Pacific Source, we're in four CCO regions, Marion and Polk being one of them. And so overall, for our entire CCO work, we invested $2 million to do outreach and engagement strategies through memorandums of understandings with local CBOs that we know serve our HOP members. We've also been doing a lot of trainings around CCO 101 with our community partners and also with members. Our customer service team has prioritized calling our HOP members to welcome them to our CCO and to guide them through our welcome packet. And so I won't go through all of these, but here's just an array of the current strategies that we have implemented across our CCO regions, including my region, which is Marion and Polk. Okay, and then we'll go on to the next one. So we're specifically going to focus around our project with launching our radio PSAs. So this is a project that stemmed through a lot of conversation, not just internally, but also within our community. And so we created six public service announcements, PSAs, that will be aired through a local radio station, a community radio station called Radio Poder. One of the things that really excites me about this project is that the PSAs will be recorded in Spanish and also in six indigenous languages. So that's Mixteco Alto, En Bajo, Zapoteco, Purépecha, Mam, and Quiche. And these will be played here in the Marion and Polk region, but we'll also be able to play them throughout our other CCO regions. And this is something that we're really excited about, and our project is actually about to launch here in September. Okay. And then I'll hand it over to, I'll go on to the Y Radio, and then I'll hand it over to Gustavo, who'll talk about the Latinx community. So one of the things that we took a deep dive in before we even went into this project is we looked at the data that we had available around our HOP membership. And so one of the biggest things that we saw is that the majority of our HOP members are Spanish speaking and primarily are from Mexican descent. We also saw that there are HOP members that speak indigenous languages from Latin America, including the ones that I just listed in the previous slide. We decided to really use radio because some of the feedback that we'd received from our community is that, you know, our members receive large welcome packets. It's a lot of information for them. And so there's still a lot of confusion for them, especially for the folks who do not read English or who have a language that they prefer other than English. They also have still lack an understanding around what a CCO is, like what a Pacific Source, what it is that we can do for them, and how we fit into the healthcare system. And then the other neat thing that we did is we were really able to bring in our staff who identify with this community to be able to also bring their lived experience and their experience working in this community to come up with creative ways to reach this population and to make sure that we were reaching them in a way that was culturally and linguistically appropriate for them. So I'll hand it over to Gustavo, who can talk about like the Latinx community and then the radio station that we worked with.
Hi, everyone. Thank you for this opportunity. Well, what can I tell you? The Latinx community, as you know, is very diverse. You know, the Latinx, we come in all shapes and forms, and we have all kinds of backgrounds. And La Voz del Pueblo is the radio that is Radio Poder. There used to be Radio Movimiento. And one of the pieces that I want to share with all of you that, you know, talking about popular education, some of the ways that people communicate in a lot of the Latinx countries is to radio novelas, you know, that's the way it started like 30 years ago, but it's very embedded in our community that we're storytelling, you know, so the radio has helped us to communicate in the past in some of the work that I've done, but this time around, you know, if you can move it to the next slide, one of the pieces that we've been looking at is that a public radio can help the Latinx community to preserve their cultural identities and providing access to, you know, obviously news, legal and health information. They do have a lot of cultural programming already, and they have access to local resources. So Radio Poder has already been doing their job for a long time. Now they're just expanded a lot more. So if you're not familiar with Radio Poder, they're actually in Woodburn. And as we put in here, they actually reaches over 300,000 people in the Willamette Valley, and it goes, you know, from Eugene to the coast to Portland. So and in the area of Woodburn. So it's a very large area, which is over 8 counties, you know, and obviously there's the 2 counties that we serve. And one of the other pieces is that they have been research studies, you know, 2018, and the last one was in 2023, where there actually been reports in how the Latino community, even though there's other media, ways of media, they still have the radio, you know, as one of the main points to get a lot of their news and information. And I can tell you firsthand, it's because they still do a lot of the labor work. So doing labor work allows you to actually listen to the radio. And then when people speak in your language, you know, or the native languages, they also build trust. So that's the reason why we are going to this project. And I'm very excited, you know, and hopeful that we will gonna get closer to the people that we serve. Because as you know, the OHP expanded in 2023. So now people of any age or any immigration status, you know, will qualify. So that's the reason why we're here to work with these communities. Thank you very much.
Hey. Next slide. Yeah, thank you. Thanks, Gustavo. That was very well said. So, you know, we saw this problem, right? These folks are getting these packets with all this paperwork. They don't know what it is, why they're getting it. You know, we've had a lot of internal conversations about, in general, how we can increase education and awareness around the Healthier Oregon program. And a lot of the ideas came up that we kept going like back to, you know, flyers or creating written materials. And, you know, finally, it was through an internal work group where folks just kind of said, look, the papers, flyers, things like that, they're not working. And these folks don't speak English. They may not even be getting this information to begin with in their needed language. So we started with that goal of, okay, how can we reach, you know, this population and also, you know, let other stakeholders know that this problem exists and that it does need to be addressed. So we had started by setting up an internal work group. We identified a lot of our stakeholders and had some conversations with them, both internal and external. I think we engaged OHA by initially having a conversation with Maria Vargas from the CPOP team. We had a conversation with your team, with the ENC team, and we really appreciated your feedback and your buy-in for this project as well. This is something that's just been completely new for us. You know, we'd also connected with our internal marketing department to kind of let them, you know, hear about our idea and, you know, how can we do this? This is a lot of work. We've never, Pacific Source as a company hasn't utilized radio for announcements before. And then we also engaged our community partners too, you know, the folks who are actually, who are engaged with this community, with this population, the folks who are doing the work, and asked them, you know, what would be helpful, what would be successful. And so we had a lot of internal meetings, a lot of external meetings, and we were finally able to sort of get this project underway starting at the beginning of this year. And through all of those conversations, we identified a lot of themes and talking points, things that consistently came up based on the feedback from our internal staff, our, you know, CCO directors, people like Zyra and Martha and Gustavo, as well as our community partners. I mean, they were essential to this conversation. And I think the conversations with OHA were pretty essential to this work as well. I think we can go to the next slide. Yep. I think Martha is going to talk about our key themes.
Yeah, so I won't read these word for word, but these were some of the key messages that we wanted to get across. Our PSAs are only 60 seconds long, and we have six. So we wanted to make sure that we got the most important information out that we needed to get out. But throughout all of our PSAs, I think our main goal was to let people know that we are more than just a health insurance, because when our members think about insurance, they don't think about transportation. You know, they don't think about all these other things like flexible services funds, health-related social needs. So we really wanted to get that point across that, yes, we are your health insurance. Let us help you navigate it, but also there are other ways in which we can help you. And so that was great. I think our marketing and communications team and our copywriters did a great job of really working with us. We had a vision, we just didn't know how to put it all together. And they did an amazing job.
I also have to add that we also worked with Radio Poder and they provided really good feedback too, as far as like, this will work on the radio, this probably wouldn't work. And so they were really, really responsive to this project as well. And I would consider them a really great partner. And they were, I mean, they have many, many years of experience working with the farm worker immigrant community. And the other layer to this is that it wasn't just translating our script from English to Spanish, but then getting the Spanish translated to the indigenous languages. So even when we were looking at the Spanish script, we had to be really careful about how would this translate into an indigenous language that has no connection to the Spanish language.
I think we may be missing a slide, which is okay, but it was just covering some samples from some of the radio scripts, but I think it goes back to that key messaging. Oh, there we go. I don't know if Martha, if you wanted to continue on that, or I can, it doesn't.
Yeah, sorry.
Okay.
Okay. If you could go back to next steps.
I was going to do the next steps, if you'll do.
Okay.
Sorry.
Yeah.
That one just out of the order. Samples. Yeah, it was supposed to go along with your previous slide.
No worries. So yes, to the radio script samples. These are just, you know, as it says, some samples of the scripts that we were created. And so as you can see, you know, one of our points is to let our members know, really educate them that you don't just see a doctor when you're sick. There's preventative care. There are all these other things that can be done before things become too much. And now you're in this place where you're having to work even harder to make yourself healthier. We've heard feedback from our community that really is a place where we need to educate our members on. We've, you know, touched on getting no cost transportation for any medical, dental, pharmacy, or behavioral health. So these scripts that we created, I think, are also a good starting point for our members. Behavioral health is still a term that that our communities are trying to get used to. But I think the more that they hear it, the more it'll become common. And we can start these conversations with them when we're tabling at events or they're calling to get answers for any of the questions that they have. So again, we have six PSAs, all 60 seconds, and we hope that we are able to achieve what we wanted with this goal.
Awesome. Thanks, Martha. Okay, so our next steps, our goal is to begin airing these PSAs in September. There, as Martha said, there are six of them. We'll air them just one per month, but they will be aired at different times and in different languages. And each language will be aired during a time where there is already existing programming in that language. So for example, if there's a specific day of the week that they have a radio programming in MOM, then we will air our PSA in the MOM language on around that same time, just, you know, hoping to really target in on those specific audiences. And then the radio station will also make these available on their social media pages and through some of their community partners. Pacific Source will have ownership of these recordings. And Radio Poder doesn't reach all of our CCO regions. So I think our goal with, you know, having the ownership of those recordings is that maybe we can share them with our, you know, broader audience in our other regions, although we haven't exactly narrowed down how we'll do that just yet. And then we're also having discussions with Radio Poder on some additional 30-minute radio segments on various topics still, you know, relating back to OHP and Healthier Oregon. And this would be sort of an interview style segment where one of us, likely either Zaira or Gustavo, will have a conversation with the radio host and just do like an interview style session. So that's in the works. And then through all of this, we'll continue to view impact. We have specific phone numbers assigned to these radio ads. So our marketing team can go back and look at, you know, whether people are calling these numbers, how successful this is in reaching people. And then of course, I mean, I think almost on a monthly basis, we're looking at our member utilization data with the HOP population specifically. And as we do see that utilization is currently trending up, we're going to continue to keep an eye on that in the coming months, and especially during these radio campaigns. And so with that, I think that was our last slide, and we are happy to answer any questions that folks may have. Oh, thanks, Tiffany. We're really excited about this.
I think I just want to add to that last slide is that we've also heard from our partners that reaching our audience through Facebook Lives is very effective. And so I know that Zaira, myself, and some previous coworkers were asked to do 15 to 20 minute Q&As where we're on this Facebook Live answering questions. It's nothing formal. We don't come with a slide deck. It's very much we're meeting where our meeting the members where they are, and we're letting our partners tell us how to show up.
Maria, do you have a question?
Yeah, I do have a question, and this might be a question from Alexios. I'm just going to ask it. Maria Nacastro, she her, your pronouns. I work for OHA in the Equity and Inclusion Division. So I am delighted to see this. I am really thrilled about the work with Indigenous languages. I know as well as CPOP that was like a surprise for many during the pandemic. One of the things, and I'm only asking these questions because I have heard CCOs ask the same question in the Health Equity Plan. How did you figure out that these were languages that were spoken from your data sets? Where did you find data? Did you partner with, I don't know, migrant education? Or because it might not be apparent that data is there. And how did you know that these were the languages that you needed to target?
Yeah, I'm happy to take that on, Maria. So we actually have some data that we are receiving from
from the OHA, from the RealD data. And so using that data set, we were able to see that Mom was one of the languages that was appearing in the top five spoken language within the population. So that was one of them. And then the other one is that we did, at least in our region, we partnered with Mary Polk Early Learning Hub, and they have a really strong partnership with the Migrant Education Program out in North Marion County. And I actually went and did a presentation to migrant parents over before this project, before we even scripted these messages. And there were a few families there that actually did not speak Spanish. They spoke I think it was Purépecha, the language that they spoke. And so they actually asked if we could bring an interpreter with us to do that. And our partners at the Early Learning Hub helped us do some of that. The other thing, too, is that we've been working really closely with our local CBOs here in our region that work mainly out of Woodburn. And this is that they've been saying, you know, there are members that speak languages other than English, and we are seeing an increasingly high population or growing population in the Woodburn region specifically that are non-Spanish, non-English speaking, and they need to have this information in their language as well. And then Radio Poder was a big advocate for that because they have the interpreters in-house. So they were able to facilitate the use of these interpreters for the PSA project.
I want to add something. Maria, I think your question is, I mean, all questions are great, but your question is phenomenal because, you know, in the case, I'm the new hire for this project, and I've been doing this for over probably 12 years. And one of the pieces is you have to start somewhere, you know, especially with these populations, you have to start somewhere. And when they presented this and I saw all the research they've done, it's like, you know, it's much better than they already done the work, but we still, you know, we still don't know until they guide us. It's one thing to get all the information and get all the data, but it's another thing to start doing the work, and then they will guide us. What else are we going to need? But I think they've done a phenomenal job, phenomenal work into having all this data and already having all these languages, and they're really kind of hard to get, you know. So kudos to them. That's one of the reasons why I'm here. And I love the project, and I hope, you know, we're going to do our best. I just want to let you know that thanks for that question, because you have to start somewhere. And I think because everything they've done in the past year and a half, we're in a very good position to start this project. Thank you.
You have to start somewhere. I love that. I love that. Thank you, Gustavo. And thank you to the entire Pacific Source team. This is such impressive and phenomenal work in displaying the actualization, the actions that happen to reach the community. And I am absolutely honored to have had you guys be our first CCO spotlight. So thank you guys so much. I also want to just say, if there are other CCOs that are part of this meeting right now, how can they reach out to you in case they want to have more information or learn about the strategies that you employed to be able to conduct this incredible campaign?
Yeah, maybe I can drop my email in the chat for folks who want to reach out if they have any other questions or want additional information about this.
I'm going to volunteer my new hire to Gustavo because one of the things that we advocated for is to have a bilingual Spanish-English community health coordinator, specifically because of the increase that we've seen in Healthier Oregon. So I'm very, very proud and excited to have Gustavo on the team to lead a lot of these strategies moving forward once he gets his feet a little more wet.
And thanks for having us here today, by the way. We're excited about this work and we love talking about it. So appreciate the space to do so.
All right. Thank you so much for being our first CCO spotlight. So amazing work. And for other CCOs, if you are interested or want to present next month, send us an email at ccoengagementteam@oha.oregon.gov. And you can also present your amazing work. So thank you so much, Pacific Source team. Moving forward, We have our roundtable section, so we would love to hear if anyone in the audience, whether you are a CCO or OHA, want to quickly provide a little update on any project status, any kudos, celebrations, questions, comments, concerns. This is something new that we want to provide the time for you to say a little bit about your program. So if you don't have anything right now, it's okay, but just so you know, we will continue to have this in every MEOC meeting. So I'll leave a minute if you have anything to share.
I think we had something from Dita earlier with regards to 1557 changes that may have some impacts. Dita, did you want to jump in and elaborate, and maybe we can have a discussion about that?
No, I just saw it. Thank you for asking. I just saw it on your first slide as, you know, topics to consider. And I'm wondering if there's an update to share with this group, something new that, you know, is top of mind. And maybe it's too big a question for the roundtable. I'm not sure.
I would love to jump in there and kind of answer that question, Dita. So I'm going to drop something in the chat, but just for folks, if you are not part of the contracts and compliance meeting, by the way, Tiffany Regan, she, her, Aya pronounce, I'm dropping a couple links in the chat. We've been presenting, or we've done one presentation so far, but we're presenting Section 1557 topic updates at our contracts and compliance meeting. And I just put a little, like, kind of schedule links to a presentation we've already done. We've already presented about discrimination, the actual notice that's going to be required via 1557, and then also that Section 1557 coordinator requirement. This month, we're not going to present anything, but starting in September, we're going to do language access, and then October, we're going to dig into policies and procedures and the trainings that are going to be required. So I'm dropping those in chat. Let me know. I'll drop my email in chat as well if you have any other questions, but we're trying to present those kind of in little bite-sized presentations because the actual effective due dates are kind of far out. The first one was non-discrimination, and that's November 2nd, so that's coming up, but the rest are early next year. So I hope that's enough of an update, but let me know if you have any other questions.
All right, thank you. We're got 4 minutes left, so I want to go over the next slide. We will have our next meeting September 18th. Brisna's going to release a poll for you to answer. But we know that historically this meeting has been primarily virtual and would meet quarterly in person in the Salem office. And this would align with the All Plans Technical Group. We are still transitioning, and we want to ensure that we provide this meeting in the structure that best works for everyone. So if you can answer the poll that is going to come up soon, and it's basically just asking, if there was an in-person meeting, would you join? Yes, no, maybe. Okay, so if the poll is not working for you, it looks like for some it's not, go ahead and answer in the chat. Okay, I think you can continue to just answer on the chat. Again, with the next meeting on September 18th, we are going to have a Socratic seminar discussion. So make sure to please invite appropriate staff to contribute to this topic. And so we'll be addressing the questions At your CCO, how are you developing material for OHP members in health-related social needs, HRSN benefits? What have been some challenges or what have been some successes in this HRSN outreach? So this was a question we had, and we want to be able to provide this discussion to learn, share resources, and learn best practices. So again, please invite the appropriate staff to the next MEOC meeting, September 18th. If you have any agenda request, again, you can use that form to submit, and we will review that and see if we can add it to the next agenda. Okay, we have 1 minute left. And we are done. So thank you for the first MEOC relaunch. This, you can subscribe to any MEOC meetings, any updates to the newsletter. So thank you, everyone. And thank you to Pacific Source for sharing their CCO spotlight.
Thank you.
Appreciate you all.
Thank you. Have a great week, everyone.
Thank you.